Paul Fowerball, and we're going to be calling all the action in tonight's game against Ashland University and IPFW. And we're going to send it down to the floor right away here for the starting lineups.
First, for the visiting Ashland Eagles, a 5'8 senior from Shelby, Ohio, number 32, Heather Dennis. A 5'6 freshman from Fremont, Ohio, number 34, Natalie Robbins. A 5'8 sophomore from Galleon, Ohio, Danny Ruston. A 5'11 freshman from Alger, Ohio, number 44, Tanya Burkett. And a 5'11 sophomore from Lancaster, Ohio, number 52, Tammy Sutton. The Eagles are coached by Melanie Balkin, assistant coach Snyder, Stephanie Piper. And now for your IPFW Lady Dons. At guard, a 5'8 sophomore from DeKalb High School, number 14, Wendy Recker. At guard, a 5'9 junior from Decatur Belmont High School, number 32, Lindy Jones. At forward, a 5'10 freshman from Columbia City, Indiana, number 43, Leah Sheets. At center, a 6'1 junior from Woodland High School, number 44, Jenny Newhart. A 6'1 forward from sophomore from DeKalb High School, number 50, Tara Mazzillo. Your Lady Dons are coached by Pam Bowden, assistant coach Nikki Inzano. Tonight's officials, John Davenport and Larry Stifle.
And that's our starting lineups for tonight's matchup. And it ought to be an interesting game, Paul. Both teams coming in at a conference record of 4-5. Indiana Purdue is 11-7 overall, and Ashland is 7-10 in their overall game. So in their last matchup, though, it was a disappointing defeat for IPFW.
Right, in that matchup, IPFW lost 76-75. Tammy Scott, the center, number 52, had a couple free throws with 2 seconds left, something in that neighborhood. Coach Pam Bowden did not get good interior post play. So tonight, it's going to be important that Newhart or Mazzillo, whoever draws the assignment on Scott, does well against her. She had 35 against IPFW the last meeting.
That's right. Scott normally averages 20.1, so she was well above her average. They've got the work cut out for him, and the tip-off to IPFW, we'll see what they set up. Wendy Record goes low to Lindy Jones. She dishes it inside to Newhart off the glass, and it's good. IPFW with the 2-point lead.
First two for Newhart, and that's a good sign. One difference, though, is Tara Mazzillo is playing better now and getting more playing time. Later in the season, as it's developed, she has really come on, and she draws the assignment right away on Scott.
That's right. They look to go inside early to Scott. And the shot off the top of the key by Heather Dennis, no good, and Mazzillo with the rebound. So they go down Wendy Recker to Lindy Jones. Lindy inside to Mazzillo, turnaround shot, no good off the glass. Rebound, the Eagles.
One thing early on, IPFW looking to push, and they've been known more as a half-court team in the past, and now they're looking to come down and get the shot off right away.
That's right. Shot from the outside is no good by Tanya Burkett. Back up by Scott. And she gets it to fall. Tammy Scott gets her first two of the evening. A little bit of a full court pressure put on by Ashland University. Wendy Record goes down the sidelines, and they're going to call a foul.
That's a good look at Wendy Record. Set the assist record for a season with 143. She had 15 against Wisconsin Parkside. Broke their old record of 140. 15, that was Thursday night.
And the foul's is going to be on number 43, Leah Sheets. That's her first foul, and Ashlyn will take the ball out of bounds. We're sorry we're having a little bit of audio difficulties up here hearing, so we had a little bit of a pause there in the action. That basket is good, though, by Tanya Burkett, and it's a 4-2 lead, Lady Eagles. Lindy Jones drives the lane, shoots, and that's a quick two for her. She takes it when she wants it, and the lane was wide open.
Sort of familiar. Last time we saw Lindy Jones, career best 40, tied a school record.
Nothing
that was
but net.
Indiana.
That's right, Heather Dunn, Heather Dennis. She gets two. Pressure still on. IPFW having no trouble bringing down the ball, and Leah Sheets having difficulty getting a hold of it. It'll be called a jump ball, and it will be returned over to the Ashlyn University. So Ashlyn with a two-point lead early with 17:55 here remaining in the first. IPFW playing man-to-man, causing a little bit of trouble for Ashlyn, them forcing them to keep the ball outside. I'm sure that's where they'd rather have it. But that three-point shot is good by Heather Dennis. I'm sorry, we'll give that to Natalie Robbins. And it's a 9-4 ball game. Inside to Newhart. Turnaround off the glass. It's good.
Four for Newhart now. And if you're wondering, Ashlyn does put up the three-point shot. 325 attempts on the season. 17 games. I have to do my math quickly here. Roundabout figures, that's 18 times a game.
That's right. And we already have seen one. And Leah Sheets takes the ball around and gets fouled. The foul's on number 34, Natalie Robbins. That's her first. The Ashlyn Eagles playing with two freshmen on the starting lineup, two sophomores and a senior. So rather young squad out there, but they play very effectively.
This is a little surprising right now. IPFW, a little trouble with the press. Southern Indiana, much bigger team. Maybe not as much quickness against Ashlyn. Had the press on them. IPFW handled it well.
That's right. Wendy Recker with the turnover and the quick shot up off the glass. No good. Rebound by Tammy Scott. She's getting hammered under there.
Second offensive rebound for Scott, and IPFW was already having problems, as we mentioned before, with this team in interior defense.
And Jenny Newhart drew the foul. It was kind of a toss up there. There were three or four people totally wrapping around. And Scott will go to the line, shooting two. And the first one is good. And it's a four-point lead for Ashlyn Eagles. And the second one is good. So IPFW needing a little bit of offense here. Newhart to Lindy Jones, Lindy to Leah Sheets.
Smart move by Leah.
That's right. Slow it down, bring it back up front, set it up. Newhart, turn around. She was shut off. Lindy Jones tries to drive the baseline, and it was closed off quickly by Tammy Scott of Ashlyn. And tied to Mazzillo. She dishes it off to Recker. Recker pauses, shoots, off the glass, no good. Rebound, Heather Dennis. Ashlyn looking to go inside to Scott. Scott with a little bit of trouble. I was going to say handling it, but the save back to her. The shot is up and no good. Newhart with her hands on it. It's going to be called out of bounds, and it's going to be called off Ashlyn's hands last.
Ooh, might have been a gift. Lindy Jones, good help side defense down on Scott, and I think you're going to see IPFW. They have normally in the past, they want to front bigger offensive players down the low post. That time Mazzillo behind Scott. See how that develops, what they do. Jones was helping out, so they're obviously going to try and double down on Scott.
That's right. Lindy Jones dribbling the ball down. As long as she continues moving like that and the players don't close off that double team, she'll get the foul every time. And that foul was on number 52, Tammy Scott, and that's only her first. Lindy Jones through the baseline, off the glass, good, and a foul. And I believe the foul is going to be called on number 32, Heather Dennis. No, they're going to call it on number 40. That was right. He called on 45. No such player out on the floor. 40, Shani Rosten.
Yeah, no 45 on the floor.
No 45. He recalled it real quickly, didn't he, after he put that five up? That's her first foul, so Lindy Jones will go to the line, shooting one. Opportunity for a three-point play, and she gets it. So now it's a two-point ball game, 11-9, IPFW trailing by two.
already. We've seen Lindy Jones drive to the basket a couple times, leading the score right now for IPFW with 5 points. And Lindy's that type of player. She can slash and get off her shot in the lane, or she can stick around three-pointer.
That's right. Lindy Jones will take over if need be. And right there, she almost got a turnover, and she did. As they say, the last hand was off of Ashland. And IPFW gets the ball out of bounds. Mozilla to bring it in. Wendy Recker, no problem now with the press as they try to double team, but Recker continues her dribble. Goes front court to Mozilla. Shot up and no good, but tip back out to Wendy Recker, so IPFW will set it back up. Jenny Newhart in and off the glass, and that's a good shot. Jenny Newhart with the shot off the glass continually, and she gets another one to fall. It's all tied up here, 11 apiece with 15:24 remaining. Ashland Eaton.
Excuse me there, that Mozilla is going to play behind Scott tonight.
And Tammy Scott taking it on all by herself. She's going to drive the lane and draw the foul. That foul's going to be called on Tara Mozilla.
Her substitution of the night, Karen Bly coming in. And Heather Dennis will have a seat. One point I want to make there, IPFW, they're going to play behind Tammy Scott. They have to have better pressure from their guards out on top. They can't allow that empty cross to be down in the low post so easily to Scott. Make a work for it. And IPFW does have a little bit of a size advantage out in the wing positions. So that's another key. It's not all Tara's fault that Scott is getting the points on the board.
That's
she
right.
She now has 6 points already.
A little bit of bump from the back. Newhart finds Wendy Recker. Wendy from the 15-foot line, and she gets it to drop. So Wendy Recker goes two, and Ashland comes down the floor quickly. They once again look inside to Scott. Mozilla with a good coverage underneath. She's trying to cut free. Oh, nice stop by Newhart as Shaney Roston tried to drive into the lane. Leah Sheets brings it down, dumps it off to Mozilla, and the shot's no good. Rebound Ashland. So once again, Shaney Roston brings it down, shoots from the top of the key, and that's good for three. She moved so fast, I almost thought she'd got inside, but she stayed outside that line, and it's a 16-13 lead. 14-23 here, left in the first half. Wendy Recker, Ashland is pulled out to a man-to-man. Dish it inside, it's going to be called a jump ball. This time it's going to belong to IPFW. So the Lady Dons keep control. Wendy Recker will bring the ball in from out of bounds. And she sends it way out front to Jenny Newhart. Jenny looking for an opening. Tammy Scott doing a good job closing that off, but she's calling for it. The turnaround, and they're going to call a foul on Tammy Scott, and that's going to be her second. So Tammy Scott has picked up her second foul here early, and Jenny Newhart off the inbounds play. And the basket is good. So IPFW playing well right now. Ashland University brings the ball down, and it's a 16-15 lead for Ashland. Tammy Scott now out of front, and the shot is up and good. Tanya Burkhart for three. And that's about our third three, Paul.
That is the third three-pointer. And she's not even the best three-point shooter out there. The person who takes the most, Karen Bly, number 22, that came in off the bench, has attempted 79 threes this year.
And there was a three attempt by Lindy Jones, and she hit two three-pointers against Southern Indiana. Up and off the glass, no good by Shaney Roston. IPFW rebound, send it down quickly. Newhart needs to look up, didn't. Leah Sheets was wide open underneath. She dishes it off to Recker, though. Recker drives the lane, and she's going to get called on a foul. She actually slipped, it looked like, on a wet spot. And I think they're going to call number 34, Natalie Robbins, but we'll wait for the official there, and it is.
Robbins got a foot out there. I'm sure she was saying Recker fell on her own volition, but that's a 16 foul on Ashland, so picking up a little trouble right now, and that is the second foul on Robbins.
So that's two members right now for Ashland with two fouls here early in the first half. Scott and Robbins both with two.
Great assist by Jones that time. Offhand, bounce pass in, Newhart. Newhart now at six.
Ashlyn looking for a cutter, but I tell you what, don't leave him open from outside. Lindy Jones almost with the save, but she's going to catch herself on the outside line. And it's inbounds. Be inbounds to Ashlyn here on their own half. 19-17 lead for the Lady Eagles. And Ashlyn with a chance here to get a couple more. And the shot is up, and the ringer's no good by Karen Bly. Rebound IPFW. Dish underneath to Leah Sheets. Turnaround jumper short. Rebound by Jenny Newhart, and she couldn't get it back up. Loses it out of bounds.
Don't come away with any points on the scoreboard, but that's nice because Leah Sheets has been running the floor, and then finally now Lindy Recker saw where she was at, got her the ball. Leah Sheets is normally the first player in the paint both ways for each team. And Newhart with an offensive rebound. So IPFW starting to look inside. That's going to bode well for them.
That's right, the double team against Scott. But the shot is good by Kerry McGrath. So IPFW has to watch whenever they double team on Scott. It means somebody's wide open. Wendy Recker dancing the sideline there. Finds Leah Sheets open and owned. Real short jumper, and you can't afford to miss those.
Well, Scott didn't rotate down. Leah Sheets open again from 3 feet. And that keeps the transition the other way. I mean, an easy basket. You have to make that basket.
Right, Karen Bly driving the lane. She drew the foul. The foul is on number 32, and that's Lindy Jones, her first foul. Lindy usually doesn't get herself in too much foul trouble. She didn't have much choice on that one, caught herself a little bit behind. Karen Bly from the line. First shot dribbled through. And it's a 5-point ball game for the Lady Eagles. 22-17 right now. 11:46 here remaining in the first half.
I'm going to have to go back and check, but I have Ashlyn now 6 of 6 from the free throw line, and they come in shooting 65%.
Dish off to Newhart underneath, and the shot is good.
How about Wendy Recker? Does she have pretty good vision?
That's real good vision to see through that court and get that ball down there. Jenny was wide open. Good move by Leah Sheets. She cut one way. That's the way the ball went. In all reality, Ashlyn's player was cutting underneath. Ball out of bounds to IPFW.
I don't think Tammy Scott is going to run point for Ashlyn too much. She does much more damage down in the low post.
Tara Mazzilla to inbound the ball for IPFW as they run the press a little bit more effectively this time down. Wendy Recker. I'm sure IPFW is going to continue to look inside. That's been effective for them. Newhart, a little bit of trouble handling it, or I think that shot would have went up instead of an attempt at a pass underneath.
Jenny can hit the 17-footer. The pass was a little behind Mazzullo. It wasn't really Mazzullo's fault that time.
No, I think Jenny was, like I said, I think she was going to shoot that one, but when the ball went through her hand, she ended up having to put it on the floor. It was too late. Quick dish underneath, closed off. They have to send it back outside. The shot up by Kerry McGrath, and she gets it to fall through.
Ashlyn really swings that ball around. Very crisp passing that time with Kremner.
Wendy Recker to Lindy Jones through the lane, and good. So McGrath coming into the ball game, being effective for the Lady Eagles. IPFW forcing them to play outside, but we've seen the three-point shot. It's been effective so far, and that's a travel for the Lady Eagles. And the press continually there for Ashlyn. IPFW, like we said, didn't have very much problems against Southern Indiana at the press.
Well, they're trying, Ashlyn, when they do press, they're trying to double team on the far sideline. That's leaving the weak side in the low post wide open. So if IPFW is able to swing it that way, they're going to get a 5-footer almost every time.
Well, quickly back down the other way. Jenny Newhart with the pause up and off the glass.
What can you say about Wendy Recker? She has really developed into the point guard that I didn't see it happening for IPFW last year. Wendy Recker has come on and really done well. And Barb Derry got some time at point last year, and now she's moving into a shooting guard position because Recker has just developed.
And that's what you need to do, follow your shot. Lindy Jones, first one, swung its way back out. She got it, put it back up, and drew the foul. And the foul is on number 32, Heather Dennis. That's only her first foul, but that's team seventh foul. So IPFW will be consistently going to the line with 9:37 remaining in the first half. The College Cable Access Program Guide provides information about our programming, including IPFW Sports Telecast. To receive your free Channel 6 program guide, send your name, address, and zip code to Channel 6 at IPFW, 2101 Coliseum Boulevard East, Fort Wayne, Indiana, 46805, or call us at 481-6000. That guide will let you know when all these games are being played and what we are going to show, as well as many of the sporting events held out here at Indiana Purdue Fort Wayne.
Pace right now is deceiving, Christy. You're averaging right around 72, 73 points a game, and it's been up and down the floor, and Ashland has showed the press, IPFW occasionally half-court pressure. I don't think it's gonna help IPFW to get in a full running game, but then again, they did it against Southern Indiana 40 minutes nonstop. I don't know. One thing that was concerning if you're an IPFW fan is the number of minutes that Lindy Jones, Wendy Recker, and Leah Sheets had. They all played the entire game. Now, they'll be able to get away with that this week because this is the only game, really, for IPFW this week to play Wisconsin Parkside. It was not a Great Lakes Valley Conference game. That's something to keep an eye on, see if the pace and see if the starters here for IPFW do start to the hands on the shorts a little bit.
That's right. We thought that would be a problem against Southern Indiana, though, and I'll tell you, I was more out of breath sitting up here watching that game than I think they were playing. It was a good game for IPFW and a good win. Lindy Jones hits, no, I was going to say hits both. Boy, about time I do, she didn't. Hits the first from the line, and it's a one-point game. Ashton sends it down quickly, and they lose the ball out of bounds, IPFW. Tara Muzilla, and how come I just do that all the time to her? I feel so bad. Muzillo will get it right. She gets the ball in bounds, and Wendy Recker brings it down, sets up the IPFW offense. Tara with the ball looking to go inside. Jenny Newhart cuts out. Jumper is good, and I tell you, it's nice to see that because they expect her to be in there 2 to 3 feet underneath and kiss that off the glass, but she can hit it from the outside.
They have a substitution coming in for IPFW. Dottie Porch getting ready to check in. Dottie is one of the best defenders on the IPFW team.
Shaney Roston, this time the 3 points a little short, but the rebound up, no good, and a third shot, no good by Ashland, and Tanya Burkett was the last one to miss. I tell you, give them three shots, but then now the turnover, so they're going to get another chance here. IPFW finally leading by one here in the first, 8:37 left to go. McGrath goes underneath, they get it back out, 3-point shot by Burkett, good.
Or a three-pointer for Ashland. And coming in, I'd have to check on the total of the amount of three-pointers. I believe that's only their sixth attempt. Coming in, they hit 32% behind the arc.
Good move by Lindy, finding Tara inside, and she puts it up under all kinds of traffic. Ashland trying to say they had nothing but their hands up. That foul's on number 32. That's her second foul, Heather Dennis. And Dottie Porch is coming in for Tara. So Tara Mazzola misses the first. She'll get a chance for one more at the line before she comes out of the game. And she hits the second one, so Tara will take a breather. Dottie Porch will come in. So Ashland trying to set up a quick offense. They dish it inside, base drive the baseline, and it was wide open, but the shot was no good by Dennis. Lindy Jones brings the ball down quickly, dishes it to Recker, and the layup was no good. It spun itself off. Wendy's face, she looks like she's a little bit disappointed with herself. Shani Rostin drives the lane, off the glass, no good. Dottie didn't get a hold of the rebound. McGrath gets it, puts it back up and in. Can't let that happen. IPFW gets the missed shot, can't get their hands on the rebound. McGrath really the only one in the lane. And good effort by Ashlyn. Karen Bly thought that she didn't have the last hand on the ball as they knocked it out of bounds, but official called it IPFW, so they keep a hold of it. Oh, that was a bad idea by Lindy Jones. I don't know how Wendy Recker got to it. It was a battle for the ball in the backcourt. Jenny Newhart, turnaround jumper, no good, short. She followed it. Battle for the ball. She still keeps a hold of it, and it's going to go out of bounds.
One thing that's certain at IPFW right now, Ashlyn on the boards. McGrath only comes in 6'9 a game. She's one away from her average. So IPFW does, they're playing man-to-man. You block out a body in man-to-man. But Ashlyn is just very aggressive in the way they move offensively. Run a lot of hard picks, screens. And they will put up the three.
Bly with a missed three-pointer. Dottie Porch this time is going to make sure that she has a hold of the ball. No one's going to steal it from her. Quickly down to Leah Sheets. Smartly she pulls it back out front. They dish it inside to Newhart. Sheets looks for a lane to drive, and it was closed off. Obviously, the ball turned over to Ashlyn. And back to IPFW. Leah Sheets basically with a steal there. Dishes it to Porch. Back to Sheets. Off the glass for two. So IPFW pulls us back to a one-point game, 30-29, 5:34 here remaining. Sorry, 6:34 in the first half. The shot by McGrath, short. Lindy Jones bringing the ball down quickly, drive, shoots, scores. I can almost say that consistently. I tell you, she has an opening like that. She's a go-to person on this team. You can count on her for a basket when you need one.
Oh, I'm sure she enjoys the pace right now. And Ashlyn coming down. A couple errors. Last few trips down the court. Substitutions in for Ashlyn. Number 30 is Heather White.
Number 34, Natalie Robbins. And 52, Tammy Scott came back in. And coming in for IPFW.
It's Barb Derry, number 22. First time we've seen her tonight. She moves in for Leah Sheets.
Inside of Dottie Porch, stolen away by Graff, and Dottie can't keep her hands on the ball. It's basically McGrath threw it back to her, and it's out of bounds to the Lady Eagles. 31-30, IPFW leads here in the first half, kind of a back-and-forth game so far. Steal by Dottie Porch, dishes it off to Barb Derry, and she's on her own, so she decides to pull up off to Jenny Newhart. Wendy Recker was calling for it from the outside, decided not to shoot. Lindy Jones will from three. The shot's no good. Rebound by Jenny Newhart, and she gets two.
Right now, Ashlyn is a much smaller team out there. They have McGrath in and then Scott, and that's the extent of their height. Newhart slipped around with 34. And then Robbins gives up about 6 inches in that battle.
Tammy Scott, nowhere to go, has to dish the ball back off. Jenny Newhart playing her very effectively at the post. And a turnaround jumper by Scott, short, and the rebound goes to Lindy Jones, is going to pull it out, and she sees it wide open. I'll be surprised if she doesn't shoot. She does. This time it's a little short, and Dottie Porch takes it right back up. Good play. She draws a foul. I believe we're going to call it number 54, Carrie McGrath. If they do, that'll be her first. So that'll put Dottie Porch to the line, IPFW with a three-point lead. Says there, Dottie, a forward from Richmond, Indiana. She also played volleyball for IPFW.
Well, she's a good volleyball player.
That's right, she gets about. She's a joy to watch on the volleyball. I tell you, put her up on that front line. She's swinging.
She's one of the biggest jumpers you'll find in women's basketball. I don't think she can dunk the ball, but she can get up there and embarrass a lot of guys.
And she gets the second to fall. So IPFW with her largest lead of the game, 35-30. And Ashlyn with the ball. Scott having difficulty inside. If it isn't Newhart, it's Mozzillo. And the ball out of bounds. It'll stay Ashlyn's ball.
Really a two-man game that time. Trying to get Scott the ball. White was working. White will come out.
So coming back in is Shaney Rosten. Shaney was in their starting lineup. Shaney looking for someone to get it to. Finds Tammy Scott. Turnaround jumper. Good. We saw that move a minute ago. She was just a little bit short. That time it fell. 4:30 here remaining in the first half. Lindy Jones looks, drives the lane, shoots, and gets the roll this time.
She can go off the dribble whenever she wants right now, just abusing.
Oh, well, major walk there. Hello. There we got the call. Three or four steps. Got to keep the ball going. IPFW will get the turnover there. And a chance for two. Wendy Recker dishes it inside to Dottie Porch, out to Mizzou, back underneath to Lindy Jones off the glass. Nice play for IPFW, way to feed the ball.
It all starts with the entry pass to Porch. She gets double teamed, has the good vision to kick it out. Zulo 6-1.
Steal by Jones, is she gonna take it? No, dishes it to Barb Derry, and a little bit hard off the glass. Lindy almost had a hand on the rebound, but couldn't get a hold of it. Tammy Scott, short jumper, good. She reminds me a lot of Lindy Jones. Give her the ball. She's good for a bucket. Earlier, she wasn't able to hit that short jumper, but IPFW is playing defense very well against her right now.
It's going to be on Scott. No. Porch took steps before Scott threw her off course.
So Dottie will get a break. Jenny Newhart is back into the ballgame for IPFW. Almost back to their starting lineup except for Barb Derry, and she's going to get the rebound, the long rebound. Gets it to Lindy Jones. Lindy looks, finds Tara wide open. Tara looks over to Jenny, and the shot's no good. But a reach and foul will be called against Ashland University. 54, Terry McGrath. Terry McGrath, that's her second. So Jenny getting two from the stripe, hits the first. And gets both of them. 41-34, IPFW lead here with 2:52 left in the first half. And they're finally getting an opportunity to pull away a little bit from Ashland. There's going to be a traveling violation on number 40, Shaney Rosten. So the pace has slowed down a little bit here, Paul.
Well, you figured it had to. But again, Ashland doesn't score as much. It's about 72 a game. And we're going to figure they were going to keep that pace, scoring-wise anyway. They've turned away from the press. They do go a little deeper in their substitution pattern than IPFW does, though, about nine players. IPFW normally about eight.
Turnover. Scott too hard off the glass. And, oh, they're going to call a foul against Jenny Newhart. I think she had all ball. A lot of people are yelling on that one. I tell you, I had a good advantage point for that one. I didn't see a hand anywhere but on orange. But that's the difference, too. I had a good vantage point. I'm not down there on the floor looking through 10 players.
Are you trying to draw me into this? Because there's no way. I mean, I'm not going to say anything. But we could get fined, right, if we talk about it.
All right, 41-34 and 35 as Natalie Robbins hits the first from two.
Well, just judging by Newhart's reaction, I'm pretty positive she was saying the same thing you were.
That's all right. And the second one is good, so it's back to a five-point lead. And I don't know where that pass was going by Tara, but it was definitely not to the IPFW player, and she's going to turn around and then get a frustration foul.
She compounds the problem. I think she's trying to throw a fastball. It was really sort of a split finger, just sort of got away from her. Good idea, IPFW releasing. You can see Ashland is starting to tire a little bit. Scott has been out on the floor a lot. Bly guys came in off the bench. And McGrath, number 54, has been out there for Ashland.
So the first shot is good by Natalie Robbins. And she cuts the lead to four, and a chance to cut the lead back down to three if she hits the second. So IPFW with a couple turnovers there. She misses that, but the rebound is good. Shot is no good by Karen Bly. And a break for IPFW. Lindy Jones looks underneath it, and it was kicked. So new shot clock on that. IPFW will take it out from underneath the basket. Lindy Recker, and good defense by Ashland.
Reset the reset. IPFW's won four straight, and they've been doing it really with pretty good offense down in the low post, Jenny Newhart and Tara Mazzullo. But this person right here with the ball, Lindy Jones, has been the catalyst.
Barb Derry dishes it out to Newhart, and that nice short jumper, Jenny Newhart gets two.
Well, Jones and Newhart had 16 apiece in the non-conference game against Wisconsin Parkside Thursday. Wisconsin Parkside is going to join the conference next year.
Well, unofficially, I would say Jenny has about 10 or 12, so she's on well on her way to at least shooting that well today. Tammy Scott from 3-point, no good. And a jump ball is called, Ashland. Alternate possession goes to IPFW.
Right, but a couple of things are killing IPFW right now. They have a number of good attempts down low. They're missing easy attempts at the basket. The thing is killing IPFW is the offensive rebounding by Ashland, because I'm sure IPFW will get the final half stats for you in a little bit. IPFW has more field goals than Ashland, and Ashland is converting from the free throw line. Even though they're not shooting well, they're getting the offensive rebounds, and it's keeping them in it.
That's right. The inbounds play definitely was sent in to Tammy Scott, and the foul was called on Wendy Recker. Wendy was like, I didn't touch her, but obviously somebody got it on her, and Scott gets a shot from the line, hits the first. She's one more left. 43-38, 1:41 remaining here in the first half. Scott misses the second, and Barb Derry brings down the rebound. Tammy Scott is only a sophomore for the Lady Eagles. I'm sure we'll see a lot of her in the next few years against IPFW, and Jenny Newhart gets the roll. A ringer, as a lot would say, is it rolled the outside of the rim before it dropped through. Tammy Scott looking underneath, sends it outside. Now they're trying to feed McGrath. They're leaving Scott open for the three-pointer. That's the second one she's put up here, and the second one she's missed. Barb Derry sends it outside. Wendy Recker takes a shot and gets two.
Never fails to amaze me when I watch Wendy Recker shoot. She throws up a knuckleball and draws nothing but the bottom.
And a bad pass by Scott. Interesting, they pulled her out to an outside position trying to feed McGrath underneath and shake it up in there, and it's not working to their advantage right now. Lindy Jones from the outside, no good. Rebound, Lady Eagle. Sheenie Roston with the ball.
This time down the floor, watch how far back IPFW packs their man-to-man. It's really sort of a matchup zone, man-to-man look about it. Look how far back they'll pack it.
Boston to McGrath. McGrath wide open through the lane, gets an easy two. So it's a 7-point ball game with 11 seconds here. IPFW with a chance to score one more time before the first half is over. Mindy Jones to Recker. Recker inside to Newhart. Jenny up and didn't draw a foul. And that's it for the first half. So IPFW will go into the locker room with a 7-point lead, 47-40. And it's a lead for them. That's all I can say right now. IPFW playing a little bit more effectively than they were when they came out on the floor.
Well, as we've seen lately, IPFW going to try and threaten the century mark. They've done it twice in the last four games, 104 against Southern Indiana. They've really picked up the pace, and I think IPFW is getting used to this up-tempo game. I really like Lindy Jones in the open court, and Wendy Recker has played well. It's just in that wide-open type of attack.
I think we can attribute a lot of that to Pam Bowden, the new head coach for IPFW. I think she likes that kind of game. She's got the players who can play that kind of a game, and she's got a bench who can come in and fill in if someone's tired. Although, like you said, Paul, we did see quite a few players play the full length time. You know, three players against Southern Indiana, and so far, Lindy Jones hasn't come off the floor. Again today, nor has Winnie Recker. So we're going to see them stay out on the court. And we'll be right back. Stay with us for more exciting GLBC action right here on Channel 6.
First-year IPFW women's basketball coach Pam.
Die Welt verändert sich sehr schnell.
Изменения здесь достигнут весь мир.
Сегодня каждый народ, вообще мы, соли не вместе, ирона, 方法を 考えなくてはいけません.
De plus en plus, nous deviendrons tous partie d'une communauté internationale.
Todo el mundo tendrá una oportunidad para formar parte de este cambio.
If there is a common language in the world today, that language would be change. Sometimes evident. Sometimes hidden, it is nonetheless constant. And when viewed through the eyes of the world, this change can be wide, sweeping, immediate, and profound. Yet when viewed through a different set of eyes, through the eyes of a child, this change can be personal and at times bewildering. Consider a child from another land whose family has come to Indiana, brought by an international company or organization to America's heartland. For this child, a changing world is felt at a personal level, a level of new language, atmosphere, customs, and new friends. There are more and more children like this one throughout the communities of Indiana. Part of the promise of the years ahead is that there will be many more. The coming international era, it has been called an era in which local economies, institutions, and industries around the world merge and interrelate to an extent far greater than ever before. It will be an era when Indiana's place in the world may depend upon the ability to remain open to the world around us and adjust our ways of thinking and acting. Recently, a group of citizens from around the state, representing many walks of life, came together to form the International Issues Task Force. A group formed with the purpose of determining and enhancing Indiana's ability to thrive in an increasingly international environment and prepare recommendations for the future. In part, the task force considered issues related to the Indiana business community, but their scope extended much further. Because at the heart of all changes are people. And closest to people are basic human issues. Issues that directly affect our ability to work and participate in an increasingly international atmosphere. With this in mind, the task force identified four primary areas of investigation. An international school, international service organizations and communications, international transportation, and international education. Each topic was studied by a separate committee, with ongoing staff support and administration provided by the Indiana Humanities Council. The intent of each committee was to determine how to best prepare the people of Indiana to become more valuable and productive citizens of the world community. The International School Committee investigated the feasibility of establishing an international school in Indiana. A school which would serve the needs of Indiana children by creating the opportunity to learn in a unique, world-class educational environment. A school which would also serve the needs of the children of foreign business people, students, educators, researchers, and other visitors to Indiana. As the business of many Indiana companies becomes increasingly global, the need for an international school becomes ever greater, because at the center of the needs of any family is the education of the children. Another task force committee investigated the statewide delivery of international services and information. Indiana is home to many different international service organizations. Yet a study commissioned by the Lilly Endowment revealed a need for these organizations to work more closely together. The task force committee investigated the needs of international employees and their families, foreign students, researchers, and the professional spouses of international executives to determine if services were readily available to international families. For example, foreign families often need special assistance in adapting to their new environment, obtaining driving licenses, learning where and how to meet American friends as well as other foreigners, and generally learning about a new culture. The committee also investigated ways to raise the consciousness of the people of Indiana by providing opportunities for exposure to international cultures through these service organizations. The committee then explored ways to best coordinate, fund, and deliver these needed services to international families as well as Indiana citizens. Central to Indiana's ability to be a vital part of a changing world is transportation. And a task force committee was formed to investigate the possibilities for increasing direct air transportation from Indianapolis International Airport to overseas cities and markets. Many Indiana companies, as well as international business people and visitors living in Indiana, currently need direct air service overseas. The committee not only studied this issue, it developed a strategy for pursuing greater levels of service. International transportation, an important way to more directly link Indiana with the world. The mission of the first three committees was investigating ways to make Indiana even more hospitable to foreign visitors, executives, employees, and families. The fourth committee investigated ways of preparing the youth of Indiana for the international era by studying the present educational system. The committee evaluated the teaching of world geography and culture, world history, foreign literature, and foreign language in an effort to assure that Indiana students are provided with the knowledge and the skills to succeed in the international era. In many ways, the intent of the task force has been to provide a cornerstone from which the state can begin to build and prepare for the future. A future that is rapidly approaching for businesses, for organizations, for families, and for all of us. It is up to us to shape our place in the international era by learning the language of the world, the language of change. The International Issues Task Force has provided an important first step for the people of Indiana, a step toward becoming citizens of the world and making countrymen of all humankind.
The 101 Dalmatians is one of the most beloved children's stories of all time, and now is coming live to the stage.
101 Dalmatians sings a lot of fun.
Pongo, Cruella de Vil, they're all brought to life in this new musical stage version, and the audience becomes the 99 dog nap puppies as they bark and join in the fun of the 101 Dalmatians.
Just do it. It's a cool place. Call now. Go to work, go to school, go ahead.
Some of the first half action. Ashland only shooting 39% from the field, but they were very effective by shooting 83% from the free throw line.
Sure, 13 field goals. IPFW has 20. Ashland only down by 7. They did hit 4 three-pointers, and they hit 40%, which is pretty good for them, normally 32%. The numbers for IPFW, I mean, Jenny Newhart's stat line just hits you right in the face. 11 of 14, 24 points.
24 points. We were definitely a little bit off there, Paul. At our guesstimates, where she were as we lost score there.
Oh, I didn't guess. I guessed.
I was only about half, though. But that definitely is a surprise, but a very good one for IPFW.
Well, to put it in perspective, Christy, that's her career high. She ties a career high, and she comes in here 12 plus a game, Great Lakes Valley Conference. She has a full half to improve on it.
She
keeps getting the same shots 3-5 feet away from the basket, and Wendy Rucker keeps looking for her. She might come close to tying Lindy Jones' record of 40, and Lindy Jones shares that with Lisa Miller.
That's right.
So she's got an outside shot at breaking the school record here tonight.
Well, we'll see what happens. Lindy Jones coming in the ballgame here with 14 points in the first half. Wendy Rucker with 4, filling out the rest. Leah Sheets with 2. Dottie Porch has 2. And Tara Mazzillo with 1. So IPFW 55%, 77 from the free throw line. And first shot's no good by Lindy Jones, and the rebound knocked back by Lindy to Leah Sheets. To Jenny Newhard, up, and the shot's off. Wendy Recker with the rebound and gets it to fall.
Well, they just cured the rebound race there on offensive rebounds. Now both teams with 8 apiece. Rebounding pretty even, though.
And another miss for Ashland. Will give the ball to Wendy Recker. She comes down low. Leah Sheets drives the baseline, shoots, and finally gets 2 to fall. Leah having trouble, but a good feeder today. Not getting many shots off. Gets that deuce.
Double digits, first time for IPFW, 11-point lead.
Shani Austin sets up the offense. Out to Scott. Scott looks to go in inside. Burkhart back up front. Steal by Wendy Recker. Wendy and Newhard, and Wendy takes it up by herself and gets it off the glass. So
it's 8 for Recker.
Recker getting a quick 4, and a timeout's going to be called. Melanie Balcombe decides that she doesn't want IPFW to run off any more than they have already. It's a 13-point lead, 53-40 here, only after about a minute here, Paul.
A 6-0 run. Ashley did not come on the floor until there was a minute left. Halftime. Take another look. Wendy Recker coasting off the steal. Nothing to it. Right hand off the glass. And we mentioned before, Wendy is really known for giving up the ball. She comes in here tonight with 143 assists. She already has 6 this evening, so she's just going to keep adding on to that year total. New record. Really not much to say. The IPFW bench, Bam Bob just sort of going over the team, bouncing to the beat of the pep band.
I'm sure at this point what else
they're in rhythm on the floor.
Can Pam Bowden tell them they're playing well? That's right. They're in rhythm on the floor, and Ashland's the one that needs to pick up the pace, and we'll see if what she had to say to them will be effective here as they have the ball offensively and try to set up for 2. Right there, a bad pass out of bounds.
I guarantee you. Melanie Balcombe wasn't talking about turnovers.
I don't think so. Shani Roston went for the pass, but the cutter once again went down toward the basket. The pass didn't follow. Lindy Jones inside to Newhard. This time it was batted out. I'm sure they discussed that during halftime. Wendy Recker going to be called on a travel. Looked to shoot the 3-pointer, kind of paused, put the ball back down, and got caught. Tanya Burkett has, for the Lady Eagles, I'm sure, has been told to get a hand around Newhard, not allow that easy pass underneath.
That's what they're trying to do. Rub off the screen on the high block. Cut her towards the basket. Sheets got a hand on the ball that time. Clock is only at 15.
Oh, I'm not sure that was a pass, but I guess it was 34. The shot is no good. Natalie Robbins back up by Heather Dennis.
It's only her second basket. She comes in here. She's one of two players in double figures, averaging 10.1 a game.
Jenny looking at each pass to turn to go to the basket. Lindy Jones will drive in, get 2. I think Jenny knows she's playing well and definitely on record pace. Would like to get a few more buckets at least. Nothing else for the second half. And the driving shot with a foul by Natalie Robbins. No shot basically. It was no good, but she'll get fouled. She was fouled and will get 2 from the line. And the foul's on number 43, Leah Sheets.
At the line, number 34,
there's a good shot on Leah.
Leah's really come on. She's just a freshman out of Columbia City, and great success that high school program has had under Wayne Krieger. She's obviously been in a winning situation, a number of sectional strings at Columbia City, but the thing that is just so impressive about Leah Sheets is the way she runs the floor. She is consistently the first player down the floor, both ends. And she's 5'10", so it's not like she's a 5-2 guard, and she's supposed to do that.
That's right. The ball's thrown out of bounds by Wendy Recker. A little bit of frustration. Ashland will have the ball, 55-44, 11-point lead for the Lady Dons, 17-20 here in the second half. Scott with the ball. This time she's open. She turns around, 15-foot jumper's good. So Scott has been covered all night. She wasn't even really looking to shoot. She turned around, found herself wide open, decided to put it up.
And there's that press, the half-court double team on Recker. They force her baseline. Once again, if Recker can beat that and swing it to the opposite side, Jenny Newhard was really all by herself underneath the basket.
And the shot is no good. Rebound, Newhard, not Newhard. Scott, turnaround jumper, no good. Rebound, Jenny Newhard. And a foul as Jenny's attacked underneath. I believe the foul is going to be on 44, Tanya Burkett. No, they're going to call on 42. 32, Heather Dennis. That's good. There's not a 42 on the floor. I'll wake up.
I'll just take your pick. It was a mugging down there underneath. Ashland is concentrating on going to the boards, though. I think that Coach Balcom feels that Ashland is going to have to beat IPFW from there.
And there's a good move. Oh, they're going to call it an offensive foul. No basket. Lindy Jones with a great move underneath. Switched the ball, the dribble to the left hand, went right around the player, put it up. I think that was definitely a Grammy-winning, Oscar-winning performance. I don't know how much connection was made down there, but the call was made, so that's Lindy's second foul. And Ashland will take control of the basketball. Let's see what happens here as Shani Roston drives, tried to get it off to Scott, but it got deflected by Mazzillo, who sent down to Leah Sheets off the glass, no good. Leah was hacked, though. She would have really had to power that up to get that to go.
You see, this team is starting to click now. They've won four straight, and they're sensing where each other are going to be on the floor. I mean, Linda comes down the court. She's not even at the half-court line. She releases that pass to Sheets. Sheets is going to be in that spot. Lindy knows it. Result is two free throws.
Chance to put it back up, the lead into double figures. And the first one's no good. So it's still a 9-point lead for IPFW, 55-46. Shot of Cam Bowden, Nikki Azzano, assistant coach for IPFW. Both new to the program.
Alaska Anchorage, that's a long way to come.
It's a long way. They should be happy with the snow we're getting right now. They're probably pretty used to a lot more than what we've had so far this year. Roston driving, doesn't get the roll. And geez, a foul is finally called as Lindy Jones is tackled almost underneath by McGrath. And I tell you, McGrath was really the only one around her, but Dennis is going to pick up her fourth foul. I guess she got her first and McGrath second. Leah Sheets looking underneath. Newhard was open for the shot, didn't get to her in time. They go into Tara Mazzillo. Off the glass and good. 58-46.
And all the starters on the floor for IPFW have scored this half, except Jenny Newhard.
And Natalie Robbins connected on the three. Jenny Newhard, she wants a hold of the ball. She hasn't seen it a lot lately. Lindy Jones looking to go inside. It's covered well. Wendy Recker drives the lane.
Now swing it down.
That's right. Back out to Lindy. Shot's no good, and IPFW too far into the basket to get a hold of the rebound. Dish off to Robbins. Robbins underneath to Scott, and they try to get it back out to Robbins, but Sheets and Newhard are right there to get their hand on the ball. It's a good shot there of Tammy Scott for the Lady Eagles. Normally their high point player with 35, only with 11 at the half.
That was against IPFW and a porous defense, and you can see the last time down off the inbounds play, IPFW had her triple teamed on the baseline.
Natalie Robbins with the basket for Ashland. Lindy Jones drives the lane, stops, shoots, good. So Lindy taking it on her own that time. It's back to a 9-point lead for IPFW. Robbins looking to send it inside. Leah Sheets all over her, almost with the steal. Roston up front. Outside to Scott. Dennis back up to McGrath. McGrath to Scott. Scott finds an opening in the lane this time. Drives and stolen away. Jenny Newhart got a hand on it. Lindy Jones is bringing it down the floor. Lost control. Good eyes of Wendy Recker to Sheets. Oh, and she doesn't get the roll, but Jenny Newhart gets two off the glass.
First bucket for her. It took 6 minutes to get it the second half now. 26, game high.
I think they spent a little bit of time in the locker room talking about how to stop Jenny Newhart.
The problem is with that, though, then you have Lindy Jones.
That's right.
On the same team.
I sure wouldn't want that. That's a problem with IPFW. I wouldn't want to come in and have to figure out how to defensively cover them. If you shut off one, you've got a second one open, and that's something that you got to work on. So obviously Newhart was getting all the passes in the first half. You definitely want to slow her down. Lindy was making her shots, but definitely not near as effective as Jenny was being open underneath the basket.
It's Mazzullo's third foul, and just to expand on that point, Ashland is throwing a couple bodies at Newhart in the low post.
Throwing literally.
We'll
add a little bit to that, getting pounded underneath the basket. But I remember Pam Edwards, a good post player for IPFW, that was her game underneath. She played a rough game and would have liked to have had that action going on. Newhart off the glass, and there we go. There's another bucket for her. So she gets two here in the last minute for IPFW.
Split the double team that time, now with 28.
Shot good by number 30, Heather White. Lindy Jones. Oh, look for Leah Sheets, and that time White was there to get the ball, but I think they're going to say she stepped on the line, and she did. Tough break. She knew she had the ball, stole it away from IPFW, but just a little bit far over and caught the foot on the line. So Lindy Jones will inbound it. IPFW looking down low. Leah Sheets. White playing her. Newhart sends it back out. Lindy Jones, and that's two. 66-54, 12-point lead, IPFW, 13:02 here remaining in the second half. McGrath not able to get a hold of that, but it was tipped off by IPFW, so Ashland will keep possession. Roston gets it into White. Robbins looked to go down the lane, back out to White, and once again she's going to get caught on the line, so twice in a row she gets the call.
That's a 2-point deduction there, and it is a turnover. 20 now for Lindy Jones, so maybe Lindy's feeling a little pressure on the record.
That's right, and Leah Sheets steps back on her dribble and catches the line back on the other end, so little problems playing the court a little wide here right now, Paul. White brings the ball up floor. IPFW waiting for them to come down. Once again, Ashland had put back on the press. McGrath outside to White. Tammy Scott. And McGrath's going to drive, shoot, and definitely was fouled by Jenny Newhart, and we'll get two from the line.
And IPFW has not substituted this half. About 8 minutes deep in. Ashland, however, will bring Missy Wilson in, 6 foot center.
Take another look at that. She drives the lane. Jenny taps her back on the back side of the arm. Not a real hard foul, but the shot wasn't going in. She'll get two from the line. The first is good. I'm sorry, you said that.
Yeah, I already got that. No
you
problem.
You got me covered, Paul. Tells you how much I was listening.
I'll let you have next.
All right, coming in for IPFW is going to be Dottie Porch. And the second one's no good, but the rebound goes to Ashland. Robbins to White. Back out to Robbins at the point. McGrath looking to go inside. Drives the lane. Shoots short jumper. No good. Back out to Ashland, and they're going to drive it in. Shoot. Newhart got a hand on the ball, and Mizzullo ends up with the rebound.
It's Newhart's 88th block of the season. She broke a record earlier, or 88th block of the season. That'd be nice. 88th block in her career. She broke a record of 80, held by Pam Edwards, going on the floor to get it.
Newhart gets the steal. Leah Sheets with the short shot. Actually, she was bumped, but it didn't go. And White brings the ball down. Shot is up. Shani Roston with two.
Thank goodness. There were a couple of ugly possessions right there.
Shani Roston ties up the ball for a jump, and possession narrow goes to Ashland. So Dottie Porch is coming in, and Tara Mizzullo is going to get a break. She's dragging right now. Setting up the offense, trying to clear out that lane a little bit. To Robbins. Robbins looking inside. Robbins drives, shoots, and stole away by Newhart. And Wendy Recker picks it up. She's going to bring it down the floor. Got lucky she got called on the foul as she traveled, but Heather White will get called.
Newhart, another block. I shortchanged her one. Another look. That Recker on the break.
I get a second look. See, I guess the drag was because she got bumped, but that's all right. Dottie Porch off the inbounds play against two. Back to 11-point lead for IPFW, 68-57. 10:39 here remaining. White dribbling around, finds McGrath inside. Back out to Austin, and Jenny Newhart with the steal.
Three straight blocks for Newhart.
For White. She brings it down quickly, but she's going to slow it up. Set up the offense as I thought. Three, no good. Dottie Porch with the rebound.
Maybe should have set up the offense. Down by 11. Take your time right now. Up and down. It's right. Not Ashland's game.
No. They were in it early, but they're definitely out of tempo on it now. And Dottie Porch with the bucket.
Back to back. Porch now with six. Lead back up to 13. Contact on the floor. How about that? Lindy Jones can find a contact on a floor, huh? Says something about her finding the open space in an opponent's defense.
I don't think I could put my contact back in. I'd have to rinse it off. Daddy got it in immediately, though. 70-57.
She's known as a gamer.
Hey.
Get it back in that quickly. You don't care what's on the floor. Just wipe it off, put a little spin on it, and get right back in there.
There you go. 70-57 IPFW. And they're looking to go inside, even to Missy Wilson. And Newhart again with the steal. This time the lead to Leah Sheets. And she gets two off the glass. So if Newhart isn't getting the bucket, she's getting the assist. What a game right now for Jenny Newhart. And we're going to have another timeout for the Ashland Eagles. Melanie Balcom, 72-57 lead for the Lady Eagles. I should say, for IPFW, you're not going to give the Eagles anything.
Not as big as the lead of the game for IPFW. Jenny Newhart's sitting on 28 points right now, only four in the second half. She's doing it with the defense. So we'll take a break right now. We come back. IPFW, more Great Lakes Valley Conference action.
First-year IPFW women's basketball coach Pam Bowden is enjoying a fine preseason after coming to IPFW from the University of Alaska Anchorage. She has inherited a club which returns no seniors but still enjoys one of the top ratings in the Great Lakes Valley Conference. We want you to tune in every Wednesday at 7:30 to find out more information about the IPFW women's basketball team all season long.
Threw it out of bounds, and I think should have drawn a foul there. Dottie Porch got it, tried to go across to Leah Sheets, and turnover for IPFW as well. So I'm sure Melanie Balcom, both times she's called a timeout, her team has come out and turned over the ball right away. Wilson up front. Back out to McGrath, to Wilson. Robbins looking nowhere to go.
Right now there's not a lot of scoring on the court for Ashland.
Wilson with the rebound, trying to put it back up. Oh, great save by Dottie Porch as she takes out the ropes at the other end. Leah, Wendy Recker to Leah Sheets. Oh, she's going to get called. Not on the travel, she was up and down, but Wilson's going to get called with the foul first.
What an entry pass by Wendy Recker, lobbed it inside, Sheets cutting the basket. Then again, I mean, the points illustrated, these players are starting to become familiar with one another. But if you're Ashland right now, you don't have your two leading scorers out there. Tammy Scott on the bench, 20 points a game, she's got 15 right now. And of course, Heather Dennis has been on the bench most of the second half with four fouls.
Sinks the first one.
She's got 8 points.
And we're taking a look at that. She came back, and not much more that Missy Wilson could do, but you're in the wrong position down there. Leah had the ball trying to put it up. So Wilson will inbound for Ashland.
Now IPFW working on the biggest lead of the game was 15, now 17, 74-57.
They're going to make the 100 point there.
Oh, we're going to have to shoot some fouls.
Save is good, and Wendy couldn't keep her hands on it, bobbling it out, trying to get it to Lindy Jones.
IPFW 8-19 to score 26 points. I don't know. They scored that many right off the bat in the open of the game, but Ashland was leading actually 1.7 minutes in at 25-23.
Missy Wilson and Natalie Robbins come out of play for Ashland.
Now you get your scoring back in. Dennis and Scott both check in.
McGrath, 4-2.
It's been a good decoy. They swing Scott outside, and McGrath goes to work with low post. And she's 6 feet two. She's only a freshman.
Pressure's back on, but Lindy Jones says that's all right. Drives, didn't get it to go. Tara sends it back out to win to Leah Sheets. Wendy Recker at the top of the key. Goes inside Dottie Porch, wide open off the glass. Good eyes for Wendy to see Dottie cutting in. At the low post, and McGrath off the glass, no good. Rebound by Lindy Jones. So the IPFW is still keeping the up-tempo. Tara Mozilla with the air ball shot. Wendy Recker with the save, though. Leah Sheets, Lindy Jones out front, two. 78-59, IPFW continually pull away here in the second half.
Jones now.
Rostin gets it inside, and the shot's good by Dennis. So bring back in Dennis and Wiley. Like we said, that's the two scores, and there's a couple points for the Lady Eagles. And Record to Mozilla. Wendy Record dishes it inside. Leah Sheets, and she's hammered from behind by number 40, Shaney Rostin. And a nice hand help up. She knew she got her.
Barb Gary going to come back in. She got some big minutes in the first half, six. And Lindy Jones, 22, will check out. Jenny Newhart also going to come back in. She might come in for Dottie Porch. No, it's Tara as well.
Tara, I thought we were going to take another look at that.
Ashland, though, is going to give up some points like this because they're scrambling in their half-court defense. They put the press on him. IBFW reverses the ball, uses a skip pass. They're going to get a got a lot of muda, whatever. They're going to get some good looks at the basket.
That's right. Leah Sheets hits the first one. Going to have to get a couple more free throws, definitely, with the clock stopped, I think, to hit the century mark, but...
Another one for Sheets.
That's right. Sure get another chance. Sink this one with the clock stop. 6:46 here in the second half. IPFW leading 79-61. And she misses the second. And we've got another violation.
Who is that? So McGrath getting in there?
McGrath has got a call on her, I think, the last time there. I tell you, that's helpful. Hit the first one, missed the next two, but two lane violations and get a fourth chance, and this time she gets it to go. So
in the books, that's 2-of-2 from the line that time. It's not 2-of-4.
That's right. It's not 2-of-4, but hey, she got four chances to get that two in, and it's a good help for IPFW. And off the glass, Heather Dennis. That's it.
Six for her in the second half,
that's
eight
right.
overall.
Two baskets in a row for her. She's taking over the offense for Ashland. Barb Derry gets the ball down the floor. And IPFW gets all set up here for offense, and Wendy Recker outside to Derry, looking to go inside. Dottie Porch trying to free herself, so they dish it up front to Newhart. The bounce, no good. And it gets bounced out of bounds before Dottie Porch can get a hold of it. So Ashland will take over here, 80-63. We'll see who the go-to person this time. Lindy Jones getting ready to check back in for IPFW. Light gets it inside. And we're going to have a foul before the shot. Tammy Scott. And that should be four. That's right. Fourth foul on Jenny Newhart. Say at this point in the game, go ahead and leave her in, see how many points she can get. Not really going to hurt IPFW if she fouls out. 5:57 remaining. And they barely get it into Scott. She turns around, shot, no good. Newhart with the rebound. Lindy Jones to Dottie Porch. Dottie stops, shoots, no good. Roston will bring it down court for Lady Ashton. Goes for the three-point shot, doesn't get it. Lindy Jones with the rebound.
Undisciplined, Ashton. Expect more of those three-point bombs. That's a two from Recker.
Jenny Newhart, turnaround jumper. Oh, no good. And it's going to stay IPFW's ball.
Jenny's missed her last two shots. She had 24 in the first half. In case you missed it, 11-14 from the floor. 4 points in the second half.
Jenny Recker. Going to go baseline. Tries to get inside. Dottie Porch is being covered up underneath. Barb Derry out front. Slow dribble to Jenny Newhart. Off the glass, no good. Dottie with the rebound. Tries to put it back up and is tackled by Scott. Tammy Scott, I believe, will get the foul there.
That's pretty good low post position, though.
We're going to see it here. Oh, I guess Scott got her second. They're going to give the foul to number 30, Heather White. Her second foul, so Dottie Porch will go to the line.
She's got two. Just that was pretty good low post position because really that pass was not meant for Newhart. It was meant wing player on the outside, but Newhart had carved herself such space in there. The ball took a couple extra seconds. Still got to her.
Second one is missed, 81-63 IPFW. We're about ticking down here, 5 minutes remaining. Scott off the glass. So Scott with so heading up towards her average. She needs to get up, she does, 25. I'm thinking of the 35 that she scored the last time IPFW met with her. Out of bounds. Stays with IPFW, Barb Derry. pushes it into Rucker. Wendy's going to drive down. Turnaround jumper, no good. And the battle for the rebound.
Grath got a piece of that Rucker shot.
Roston dished it off to Heather Dennis, and it ring around, no good. Dennis gets it back. And the shot once again is no good. So Roston and Dennis both having trouble. Dennis brings the ball in. That's Jenny Newhart's fifth foul, so she'll take a seat here with 4:13 remaining.
Career high, though, for Jenny Newhart. 28 points at four block shots, three on three consecutive possessions. I would think her performance has probably earned her.
Now we'll take a look at that. She just gets it as they try to dish it in to Tammy Scott.
Probably earned her performance. Probably want to talk to her after the game.
Oh, might want to give her a little bit of a chat. I don't know, though, Paul. What do you think? 81-65, 4:13 here.
Well, if Coach Bowden wants them to fire up from the outside, they're not going to hit 100 tonight. Right now, the game is pretty much in IPFW's control. It just works the clock now. You're not worried about scoring 100. But it's been another good offensive showing for IPFW. They're really starting to come on. You see the players' confidence growing with each other out the floor.
That's right. As the team begins to gel and realize where they're going to be, the passes are going to go there, and IPFW is going to get a lot of offensive points off of that. So Ashland having that trouble tonight, not really gelling as a team. Scott from the outside, it will be 2 points. I think that was only given a 2 point. I never saw either official's arms go up.
Well, it's only two on the scoreboard, so that was not a 3 point attempt.
Off to McGrath, off the glass, no good. Lincoln Jones is going to pick up her third foul.
All of a sudden, sort of thinking this game was pretty much in the bag. Not so. Ashland coming back down by 19 a couple times in the second half, and a chance now to cut it to 12.
Coming back in is Leah Sheets for Dottie Porch.
Dottie had 7 in the second half, 9 for the game. South performance for not on my front porch.
Grass sinks the first one. So it's 81-68. Taking a look here. Dish off to McGrath, and Lindy Cotter on the arm. So she gets 2 from the line. Press is back on.
There's the pressure, and Rucker is left wide open on the other side.
So Wendy Rucker brings it up to the point, sets up the offense. Out to Leah Sheets, wide open. Scott pulled out on her. Zilla to Rucker on the other side. Barb Derry up front. And a foul is going to be called at number 40, Shaney Roston. And we're both teams are in the bonus situation, so it'll be a 1-1. Take another look at that. Barb Derry puts it down and drive. Wrap around. I didn't foul.
You're going to get the foul call every time when you put your arm across the two arms of the player. Rebound bucket by Nizula. Barb Derry had a chance to break into the scorebook. Didn't do it.
Inside to Scott, turn around, in and out, no good. Back up by Shaney Roston. So the press is in full force once again. IPFW, Lindy Jones, no problem with it though. Brings it down on her own, stop, shoots, and it's going to be fouled. I don't want to say I've been wrong a couple times, but they're going to say 52 this time, Tammy Scott. That's her third foul. So put Lindy Jones at the line.
And Lindy about on track. She's got 22. She's averaging 25 for Great Lakes Valley Conference action. 21 overall.
That's right. Give her the first. first one. We'll see if she can hit two. And she misses a second. Rebound by Barb Derry. Back out to Wendy Recker. She battles for the ball. Wendy Jones, KRPFW, to set it back up. Wendy Recker down to Leah Sheets.
Pretty soon now, clock winded down to 2:30. Ashland is going to have to think about fouling IPFW.
And off the glass is Leah Sheets. 86-71. Oh, I hope we don't get into a foul game. And a foul called against IPFW. It's going to be on Barb Derry out front.
You know, it's great when you're the team that's up. Right now, IPFW up by 15. And those 2 minutes don't seem like the 15 minutes it is actually to play. But there's got to be something done about that. The team's just giving away. There is no two-shot penalty double bonus in women's basketball right now.
And Heather White hits the first. She'll get a chance here for one more from the line. Brings it to 86-72. Chance to cut it down to 13.
Actually, the player that Ashland might be looking to foul would be this person right here. Wendy Recker only shoots 65%. Barb Derry is 66, but she hasn't had many free throw attempts. Only 15 coming into tonight.
Wendy looking to go down inside. Barb Derry, and the foul is going to be called on number 40, Shaney Roston.
Ooh, I don't know about that one. I think Roston had position.
That's right. I think Barb pushed off, but bonus. Barb gets a chance at the line here. I think we said earlier, a chance to get on the scoreboard. We'll take another look at that. So it's dished down inside, and I think it was more past two.
They called Roston on the home. The left arm there. She had it hooked around Derry.
So Derry gets her first point of the evening.
IPFW has only had 8 players play tonight, but every one of them has scored.
And she sinks them both. So 88-72, 2:06 here in the second half. Stay with us, folks. The gentlemen play right after this. IPFW men will take on Ashland as well.
And both teams are struggling to find an identity. Ashland, the men's team, under a new head coach now, assistant coach before Terry Wygand let go. We'll develop that story a little bit more. So it's a different looking team, the team that beat IPFW 90-71. That's IPFW's worst loss to GLVC. That'll be coming up 20 minutes after this game.
Right, a little bit of frustration there for Ashland. Two players tied the ball up. That's a traveling violation. I don't think they quite realized it. Somebody thought they just walked and they hadn't. Barb Derry from 3 points. 3-point land, no good. Driving down the lane, Roston up off the glass and good. So she takes the coast to coast on her own. 90-72. So IPFW with a minute 30 left to get 100 points. Leah Sheets is fouled, so that stops the clock.
1:26 to go. You want to put a clock on this one? See how long it takes?
No, I don't think I do, but I tell you, if they decide to foul and put IPFW on the line, they definitely could hit that 100-point marker here with 1:26 remaining. Take a look here. Lindy Jones drives down, dishes it off to Leah. She's just tagged as she goes to put it up. So from the line, she dribbles through the first one. 89-74, chance for one more. Pam Bowden looking on, not really much to say right now with her team up. And she drains them both. So IPFW, 16-point advantage right now with a minute 24. Great save, but to Lindy Jones by McGrath for the Lady Eagles. And Lindy Jones drives, shoots, doesn't get the roll. I wish she would have taken that move. Barb Derry got the turnaround jumper as she took it away. We're going to have an official's timeout here. As I think White was nailed in the stomach there on that play.
Well, while we have this break in the air.
action.
You too can join in the excitement of IPFW athletics by participating in the Royal Dons Club. The Royal Dons Club is the official booster club for IPFW's athletic teams. Members enjoy priority seating at all IPFW sporting events, food and refreshments in the hospitality room, admission to IPFW sports media luncheons, and association with other Mastodon supporters, just to name a few. For information on becoming a member of the Royal Dons Club, call Jan Walco at 481-6642 or write Royal Dons Club, 2101 Coliseum Boulevard East, Fort Wayne, Indiana, 46805. So it gives you a chance if you come out here frequently. It's a great place to enjoy some hospitality and meet some other people who attend IPFW athletic events regularly.
And the basketball's only going to get better. The men's team, very young, 7 freshmen on the team. And really, the IPFW women's team is set up for a great year next year. They're starting to catch themselves a little bit here. This will be their 5th straight win. And it'll put them at 500 in the conference. They're starting to inch up in the conference. Probably not enough space left at the top of the conference to win a Division II postseason bid. Definitely IPFW will be there next year. That's been a good matchup all night. Heather Dennis coming in, 11 points a game overall. And Lindy has been going at her all night.
So Ashland retains possession, 44 seconds left. It's a 20-point lead.
Biggest lead of the game.
That's right, we got a kick. So they reset the shot, although I don't think any time had gone off of it. Ashland gets the ball into bounds. Rawson drives, shoots, doesn't get it. Rebound shot up, no good. And a foul on Wendy Rucker.
Sheets got a piece of that first shot. This is going to take a while. 39 seconds left.
Sends number 40, Shaney Roston, to the line. Roston only a sophomore for Ashland University, and she misses the first one. So 39 seconds left. It's still a 20-point lead for IPFW. Knocked down to 19 by that shot. See what IPFW does. They find Lindy Jones. She brings it across the floor, and it's stolen away, but out of bounds by Ashland University. So IPFW gets the ball at the half court. 31 seconds remaining here. Wendy Recker drives down, looks inside, finds Lindy Jones, and she gets two, so it's 96-75. I don't know, two more buckets possible? Only if a quick shot down here, huh? Driving shot, no good, and the foul's going to be called on Tara Mazzillo.
Oh, yeah, Dennis is going to go to the basket. Period. She's going to go. That time Jones missed it. Check it out on the replay. Mazzillo got a large part of the ball. Foul on Jones, however. Jones now with 27, so she might even end up being the leading scorer.
Heather Dennis misses the first of the two shots. But she hits the second, so it's a 20-point ball game, 96-76. And we may get the 100 if they foul that quick. That foul's on number 32, Heather Dennis. And that's going to be her 5th foul.
Fouls on number 32, Heather Dennis, her 5th.
Suffman
So Natalie Robbins comes into the ballgame as her replacement. And Lindy Jones goes to the line, shooting 2 with 14 seconds remaining here in the second half of play. She sinks the first one. So unofficially, that ties her with Jenny Newhart for game high, both with players up with 28 points. Once again, that is unofficially. And Lindy gets the second one, so now she has 29. And an over and back call of McGrath. So with 14 seconds left, IPFW gets an opportunity to put the 100 up. Or 101 if they want to go for a three. We haven't seen too many of those this evening, so the bench is up. They'd like to see that 100 mark tonight. Leah Sheets sorry, Wendy Recker tried to dish the ball into Leah Sheets, and it was knocked out of bounds. No time off the clock, so IPFW will get it from the top this time. Barb Gary's going to bring it in, gets it to Wendy Recker. Let's see who is it going to go to. Lindy Jones probably will keep it herself. Does, but dishes it off. Oh, hate to see that happen. 4 seconds, 3, 2. That's it, 98-76. That bucket's no good. IPFW wins this game over Ashland University. Good game for IPFW, Paul.
Fifth straight win for IPFW. They moved to 5-5 in the Great Lakes Valley Conference, 12-7 overall. Had a tough start in the GLVC, playing three of their first four games on the road. And they've come back. Four straight win in the GLVC. We'll take a break right now. We come back. Christy Walker will be on the floor with Jenny Newhart. Career night for her, 28 points. We'll be back on the other side.
First-year IPFW women's basketball coach Pam Bowden is enjoying a fine preseason after coming to IPFW from the University of Alaska Anchorage. She has inherited a club which returns no seniors but still enjoys one of the top ratings in the Great Lakes Valley Conference. We want you to tune in every Wednesday at 7:30 to find out more information about the IPFW women's basketball team all season long.
Check it out!
The campus has it all.
I'm learning, I'm working, I'm playing, just do it. It's a cool place. Call now! Go to work, go to school, go ahead.
The 101 Dalmatians is one of the most beloved children's stories of all time, and now is coming live to the stage.
101 Dalmatians sings a lot of fun.
Pongo, Cruella de Vil, they're all brought to life in this new musical stage version, and the audience becomes the 99 dog nap puppies as they bark and join in the fun of the 101 Dalmatians.
The college basketball season is underway for 1994-95, and the Great Lakes Valley Conference has been rated by some as the toughest of the NCAA Division II conferences. Join Coach Andy Piazza and me, Matt DeLong, to get a closer look at the IPFW team and this year's competition.
IPFW are pleased to be able to bring you cablecasts of NCAA athletic competition. We hope you enjoyed the show. Excitement, intercollegiate sports from the Mastodon to provide such programs, we need your support. With the help of many volunteers, we are able to produce these programs at a relatively low cost. Your contribution there can help defray the production costs not covered by Channel 6 budget. There it is on the screen. Channel 6 at IPFW 2101 Coliseum Boulevard East. Fort Wayne, Indiana, 46805. That's where you send the contributions to. And you can make your check out, if you are so willing, to the Indiana Purdue Foundation at Fort Wayne, designated for College Cable Access Athletics. And let's throw it down to the board. Christy Walker standing by with Jenny Newhart, career high 28 points. Take it away, Christy.
Thanks a lot, Paul. Joining me now on the floor is our Dandy Don, Jenny Newhart. And Jenny, this was a good game for IPFW.
Yeah, we really need to win one. We've won our last, I think, four in a row. And this started the second round of our second games, and we need to really win a lot this to be able to end up good in the conference.
It seems like the team is really starting to gel right now. You know where the players are going to be and the passes are there.
Yeah, we're really trying well to, if you're a double team, kicking out, and we're working well passing it around. And Thursday we did a really good job about that too.
Well, you had a great game against Southern Indiana last week as well. Obviously, you were 11 of 14 in the first half, unofficially 24 points. Were they just getting the ball to you, or were you setting it up?
Yeah, well, it was really easy to get open in the first half because they were playing behind us, and our guards were just working well and had really good passes, and we were just trying our best.
Okay, well, unofficially, then we only had you for four in the second. What did they do at halftime? They shut you down, but that still opened up Lindy, who unofficially we had with like 29 points, so...
Yeah, we just try to work it open, try to get the open shot and mix it up so they don't know who's going to do the scoring.
All right, well, thanks a lot. This was the Danny Don of the game, Jenny Newhart, and good luck in your next game.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Christy. Musical accompaniment provided by the IPFW Pet Band, a little Sam and Dave. Jenny Newhart, Danny Don player of the game, 28 points, career high for her. IPFW 55%. 38% for Ashland. Again, IPFW 5-5 in the Great Lakes Valley Conference, 12-7 overall. We'd like to take this time to thank the Channel 6 volunteer crew and the Learning Resource Center at IPFW for their contributions to the live production of our basketball telecast this evening. The telecast of this IPFW sports event is copyrighted and is the sole property of the College Cable Access Center at IPFW. Unorthodox duplication, exhibition, retransmission, rebroadcast, and any use of this event without express written consent is strictly prohibited. Don't forget, coming up 20 minutes, the Met going at it with Ashland. And we'll be back here. Paul Harbaugh, along with Pam Bowden. Stick around.